Welcome. I would like to extend my heartfelt welcome to the 2021 Scholarships Biennial Conference to all of you. This conference has more than 15 years history, but it is the first time to be held in Asia. Compared to Europe, US, or Oceanian countries' study situation, the study in Japan in terms of the international law studies or the politics, this kind of a social study study has a certain history and accumulation. However, when it comes to the history study or the archaeology, psychology, or the educational study, this kind of humanities and arts study has not been gathering so much attention. However, nowadays, tourism, or the interdisciplinary study like environmental studies are gathering attention even in the study on Antarctic studies. In today's session, we would like to introduce the study of the Antarctic, the humanities and social studies, and we would like to study what is happening in Japan to the global researchers, and we would also like to aim at finding a trigger for the further development of this study in Japan. So that is why this session is entitled Japan Session. Then what are we going to do? The planning committee studied a lot, and we have given a lot of thought, and then we would like to, we have decided to focus on the Japanese Antarctic Research Expedition, which is usually called JARE. So through JARE, there has been a lot of the humanities and social science study. So we would like to explain the status quo and the challenges, and also the possibility for the future. That is why the title is How the Japanese the Antarctic Expedition Study Project Can Contribute to this humanities study. Of course, this national project is subject to the government's policy and the budget, and it is up to the policymakers to decide on the policy. However, in order for the policymakers to decide on the policy, they would look at the international situation or the global scientific trend, and of course, they have to look at the budget constraints or the possibilities, and also logistical possibilities and constraints. But the Japanese Antarctic Scientific Expedition Policy and or the Japanese National Strategy for the Antarctic. I believe to study this is also an important study related to the Antarctic. Today, the presentation will not only be about the expedition, the project itself, but we would like to seek the possibility of this humanities and social study research. Roughly speaking, the first presentation from Professor Murakoshi is the possibility of the study related to the psychology or the cognitive science featuring people in the Arctic. And Ms. Nakayama, who is the reporter, is going to make some insights from the viewpoint of the diverse actors, like the journalist. She's going to feature on the historical study of this research expedition. And Ms. Ikuta, she is going to talk about the actual practical education using the experience of being the part of the research expedition. And she's also going to talk about the methodology of the science study in the high school. And now I would like to introduce Professor Murakoshi. Actually, when he was born, his father was on the expedition to the Arctic. And Professor Murakoshi himself had joined the 59th JARE in 2017-18. And his study theme is the spatial recognition and navigation up to the risk cognition. He is conducting a practical study based on the practice of the intellectual behavior in the complicated environment. And he also has made the publication regarding the safety management in the field assistance on the Arctic. Okay, Professor Murakoshi, thank you for the introduction. I am Murakoshi, of the professor at the Faculty of Education of Shizuoka University. As was introduced, in 2017, I joined JARE. Ideally, I was planning to participate this year too. However, I was not being able to do so because of the health check result. That's why I have to stay in Japan. But this year's expedition has already left. I believe there are some groups that already departed and they are on the flight. Unfortunately, and because I was not able to, although I was not able to join the team, I'm really happy to be able to talk to you. And my study, as you can see here, so today my theme is the Natural Laboratory Antarctic, the Natural Laboratory for Cognitive Sciences. And this title, is the one coming from the Sudfeld and Vice the article. Their article was featured in the academic journal in 2000. And this was the title as the part of the introduction. And what they are asserting is that in the Arctic, they will be enclosed in a certain space and they will be isolated. And in this kind of environment, how the people would have the psychological adaptation or the maladaptation. In order to study this, they believe that the Arctic is the valid place to do the experiment. For more than 20 years, I've been studying the risk recognition. And this study of risk recognition is about understanding how people would capture the risk and what kind of judgment do they make in order to take action. And risk cognition is a very important topic for human existence or survival. And regarding risk cognition, we believe that the Arctic is a very good place for experiment. And I believe it would also make a social contribution for the humanities and social science study. That is the aim of this study. As you know, the Antarctic, Amundsen, Scott, or the Shirase Nobu, so for more than around 100 years, it was the venue of the natural exploration and adventure. In Japan, JARE started the study observation from 1957, and as you can see here, we have made various natural science achievements. For example, the discovery of meteorites or the excavation of ice core that more than 800,000 years, there has been a wonderful achievement of the natural science, and which I'm sure you are familiar with. Then, in the Arctic, why shall we do the humanities and social science study? When people are gathered at the study, there will be some achievements, and there will be a small society or the community when people gather. And there, I believe that there will be a theme of the humanities and social science study. And you see, the Antarctica is a very special environment, and how people will behave and what kind of community is formed and how that kind of community would function. I believe that this is an academically interesting topic. Right now, the study that is going on, as Chairman Shibata mentioned, it's about the law study or the tourism or environment issue or psychology. These kind of studies are going on in terms of humanities and social sciences. The Antarctica is now starting to gather attention as the place of such kind of study. That is why in Japan, it looks like there is a framework that is being established. And in 2016, the initiative to accept this kind of the humanities and social sciences to be done has been established. And in 2017, myself joined the JARE expedition. Furthermore, The NIPR has the midterm plan, and there was the official acceptance, and the framework has been set up to conduct this kind of humanities and the social science study. And I offered, I made an offer to this framework, and the sprouting the research, which is the development of safety education program for the field science based on the practical knowledge of risk treatment, has been adopted. Psychological study or the behavioral science research in Antarctica. This is something I would like to explain. Right now, well, up until now, there has been a lot of thesis that has been publicized. For example, Environment and Behavior is the academic journal. This is the very important the journal for the psychology, but there was a feature on the Antarctica, and there were 8 types of theses that was published, but the 7 was related to the psychological adaptation, and 1 was something related to the risk cognition. Because the Antarctica is the very special environment, there are some certain human behaviors, and there was some the thesis in another academic journal, or there is another journal called the Journal of Human Performance in Extreme Environments. And this journal also had more than 15 papers. Many of them the focuses on the isolated environment, or the, which is ICE, isolated, confined, and extreme. They feature on the psychological adaptation or the maladaptation, or the fluctuation of moods, or the depression, or the effect on the cognitive function. Those are the studies that have been done. And in these studies, there are some the wintering syndrome. In the Antarctica, in the winter, it's the dark and very cold, and how people feel in such kind of extreme environment, such kind of syndrome or the phenomena is also explained. And nowadays, through the lifestyle of a severe environment or the lifestyle, people have certain the development. It is called a post-traumatic growth, or the psychological growth. I believe you are familiar with the word PTSD. Post-traumatic stress disorder. So after having a strong stress, there will be having a psychological disorder for the time being. However, on the other hand, after having a strong stress, there will be a chance for people to grow psychological. And this is what we call the post-traumatic growth. And what would bring about the psychological growth? To clarify the factor for that, would contribute us, contribute to us so that we can survive the very difficult environment. So with these kind of the mainstreams of the studies, I am working on the risk cognition study. This is not a major study. However, I do believe that there's a worth in it. Right now, people say that our society, we live in a society with full of risk. However, the risk for the existence or the survival doesn't start here. In the natural environment, there are various risks surrounding a living creature. It's everywhere. Because in nature, the risks are not being managed. So that is why there are a lot of risk in the natural environment. The Slovic is the representative research in this field, and he describes the risk cognition in the following way. In other words, the ability to sense and avoid harmful environment condition is necessary for the survival of all living organisms. Furthermore, survival is also aided by an ability to codify and learn from past experiences. They would be able to learn from these kind of experiences, and they can codify from past experiences. So the survival is based on such kind of ability of human beings. And in order to study these kind of things, we believe the Antarctic is the best, one of the best places. For example, and this is close to Showa Station. There's the Onguru Island, and they are on the ice, on the sea. And there is the tide crack between the ice. This is a crack in the ice. You can see that this kind of tide crack is very close to Showa Station. And if you fall in the gap, it can be fatal. However, as you can see on the following slide, the members of the project don't even know, who are new to the project, don't even know about the existence of the tide crack. And they would gradually learn how to deal with such kind of tide crack, but at the beginning, they wouldn't even know about the existence and or even how to deal with this kind of tide crack. But even in this kind of environment, people can leverage the experience, and they have to survive using these kind of experience or the knowledge. And in this learning process, how knowledge is acquired and how it will be used for making decisions. In terms of cognitive psychology, I believe this is a very interesting process. I have told you that the people who are not experienced in the Antarctic cannot fully understand the risk. And this can be confirmed in my research too. This shows the result of the survey that was done in 2016 with the project members. On the left side, you see various risks that you can experience in the Antarctic. In particular, tide crack, the falling in to the tide crack, or the falling into the wind scoop. The wind scoop is something like a cliff. And if you fall from the wind scoop, you can be severely damaged, or the crevasse. And the member of the expedition has to be trained. But it shows that how this shows the result of the self-evaluation, the how to deal with these risks. And the blue shows that they have never heard or they never knew about it. But the dark blue shows that they are almost capable of dealing with this. But almost no people have the answer in green, which means surely capable. But when it comes to tide crack or the wind scoop, the majority is in light blue, meaning that the more than half of the people have never heard or knew about these risks. Or some people say that they have heard of it, but they don't know how to deal with that. There are many people like that. So we can say that the people who are new to the Arctic are very vulnerable to these kinds of risks. That is what you can tell from the slide. And then the good thing about the expedition is that to this unknown risk, how the members would learn. We will be able to track from zero how they would learn about these risks. And I believe this is particularly true for JARE. And I believe this is the great merit for the cognitive study as well. Let me dig further into the risk in the Antarctic. The people will be isolated in the Antarctic environment. And as you can tell from the photo, there will be fatal hazards everywhere. In particular, in Showa Station, basically, there is only one occasion that you can approach or have an access from outside world. So it is totally isolated. In Japan, there are some risks that can be controlled. However, in the Antarctic, that was not the case, and it can be fatal. And as I told you before, I myself, had been to Antarctic once, but since then, I've never been back, but because of the health reasons, I was not able to go back. But now living in Japan, I'm in a health good condition, and if even if there's a problem, I would get support or help. However, in the Antarctic, it is very difficult to control the damage. Under the circumstances, in Japanese, among Japanese members, there was one fatal accident. This is the current to send prayers to this person who was victimized. And once in 10 years, there is the very severe accident. And once in several years, there are some injuries, breaking bones. So we can say that the Antarctica has the environment that anything can happen. And also, in the Antarctica, there's a dilemma between the safety and the scientific achievement. Why are we going to the Antarctic? That is because we are looking for the scientific achievement. But then why can we have the scientific achievement? Because Antarctic is isolated, there is something that is unknown to human beings. Therefore, if we are looking for the new discovery, then you will be going to unknown places or the unknown environment. And of course, unknown places has a lot of risks. So this is what I mean by dilemma between the risk of the, and also the scientific achievement. And this text is something that was authored by my father in 1984. It is the introduction for the document describing, explaining the accidents. It is conscious of the dilemma between the scientific achievement and the risk. When I was born in 1964, so when there was this victim, he was in the Antarctic. He was wintering in the Antarctic, and I believe that he always has had the certain emotion regarding this life that could not be saved. Furthermore, the group in the Antarctic is quite small. There will be 100 people in the summer, but now the people who are wintering in the Arctic will be around 30. So it's a small group, but they will be confined in small place for a long time. And half of the members are the special members who are dispatched, and many of them are not familiar with such kind of special environment. So we believe that such kind of a special circumstance is the resource of the source of a risk. And also, because of all these, it is very complicated to deal with these kind of risks. And I believe we can expect that how we can identify how people deal with this kind of risk. From now on, I would like to explain the result of my study, and I would like to explain how members recognize the risk and how they deal with it.
This is about in 2011, and we did a joint research, and we tried to identify the risk knowledge and the perception about the risks by the members. This is a Showa station from the above. And this is the main body of the Showa station. And this is the administration building. And in this study, these are the risk points in Antarctic. And we put the numbers for each risk. And then what we did in the questionnaire is that whether the members will be able to foresee any risks with those points. And these are the answers. Now for the, this is one of the example of the respondent. This person identified a risk would be in number 1 and number 10, but no risks to be from 2 through 8. So that was only one example of the one respondents. And this is the aggregate of the, all the data from the questionnaire. In order to make it simplified, and I just pick up the blizzard. And this is the crevasse, the fall into the crevasse. I just picked up these two risks. So only for the number 6 through 10 locations. If you look at this blizzard, and the top one experienced, the bottom one inexperienced. If you look at the blizzard, there are not much differences in the risk perception. On the other hand, if you look at the crevasse, the fall into the crevasse, there isn't a big difference between the experienced and inexperienced members. If you look at the inexperienced, they will tend to think the risk is larger. So with the time constraint, and I cannot show you all the data, but what it shows, what all the data indicates is that inexperienced members tend to exaggerate the risks rather than underestimate that. So that means they tend to think the risk is everywhere. So let's, I would like to show you some of the data of the researches and from the qualitative way. This is about 20 kilometers away from the Showa station. As you can see, there are some crevasses here. And when we look at this, and then, and the one of the young researchers who has never been to Antarctica said this, wow, it's scary. And B. And this is a researcher focusing on the glaciers. And he feels, this B person tells, oh, I feel at peace because it's safe. So what is the difference between them? So this B knows about the structure of the glacier, and they know that about the where the crevasse will take place. And he knows about that, and because of that, he can identify where is a high risk place and where is a low risk place. So they can, he knows, and actually what is a risk place and not what, not which is not a risky place. So with this COVID-19 pandemic, and it started in the last year's spring, when we look back at those years, and I think that we overreacted to the pandemic. It is partly because of the smaller amount of the information, and we didn't know what is going to increase the risk. So that means that we were not able to be scared in the right way. And that could be because of the less information, a shortage of information. And if you look at these crevasses and the responses of the experienced and inexperienced people, they would be based on how they would respond to these crevasse threat was based on the different psychological structure. But if you understand the risk, then the response was different. This is the glacier crevasse. And on the right hand side, the that's in the sea ice crevasse. And if you fall, yes, and of course, that's fatal, but the risk is different. And the response to the risk will be different. So for the sea ice and most of the response could be done on site or in the field. And if it's in the glacier, that could be responded to beforehand. I am not going to talk about this in the interest of the time. So lastly, let's move on to the summary. So for this study, for the risk cognition and Antarctic, will contribute, have a potential to contribute for their further study. First, it will lead to the generalization of the change of understanding of risk with limited knowledges. Now, since we are human beings, we are trying to refine the risks to and the learning about the risks. And the second, and that will contribute to the cognitive model of the human behavior under the risk environment. And those are all logicals, but there is some way we can contribute in a practical way. Then we can provide the knowledge for their risk management, for their individual risk. And not only, you know, for the Antarctic and the field of science, and I think, you know, this can acknowledge, you know, what work, you know, for the resilience and, you know, strength and under a very severe condition. And we can, you know, also put the basis, you know, for the psychological and philosophical discussion. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Thank you.
So I believe this is also a risk. He had to wipe the microphone. So next, we would like to introduce next presenter is Ms. Yumi Nakayama. Ms. Yumi Nakayama, she is the first woman who joined the JARE expedition. From 2002 to 2004, she wintered in the Arctic. At the Domu Fuji station, she covered the excavation of ice bed. And also from 2009 to 2010, she joined JARE expedition. And at that time, she covered the exploration of the meteorites. And up until recently, from 2019 to 2021, she once again joined JARE. On the other hand, in the North Pole, she has been on the expedition for 7 times, and she also authored the book about the comparison of the North and the South Pole. Now, Ms. Nakayama, please.
Thank you very much for your introduction. My name is Nakayama. I'm a journalist and Asahi Shimbun. Well, I have been to Antarctic 3 times, and I think it's very rare to have this experience. And I think nobody else has been to Antarctic 3 times. And the first time that I went to Antarctic was from 2003 to 2005, and I wintered there. And then on the next one was 2009 to 2010, and I went to the Mount Salondane to collect the meteorites. And the third time was from 2019 up to 21, February of this year. So I was really attracted by the Antarctic, and not many journalists are like this. I've been to Antarctic, and I've been to the North Pole, and I call myself the pole journalist. Well, I belong to Asahi Shimbun, but this Asahi Shimbun, my company, also have a big connection, I mean a big link to the Antarctic. So let's look back at the history, Japan and Antarctic. The first expeditor in Japan was the Nobu Shirase. And I think you are aware Amundsen from Norway and Scott from the UK, and he was competing against these two troops to approach to the South Pole for the first time. And Shirase tried to call out to recruit expedition members, and then Asahi Shimbun was the one who put that advertisement or recruitment in articles. And we also donated, and Asahi Shimbun donated 5,000 yen for this project. So that was the starting year of the South Pole expedition. At that time, there was a very interesting journalist called Mr. Miki Oyada. He has joined the Berlin Olympics in 1936 as a high jumper. And he learned that International Year of Planet Observation will be going to be held in 1957 to 1958. So he wrote an article on that. And he started to think, maybe Japan can join that. And that was a starting point. And Yata said, Asahi Shimbun supported the Shirase expedition. So why don't we give some support for this project? So he talked to his supervisors, And Hirooka Tomoo and Shinobu Kamishino, those are the management parties of the Asahi Shimbun. And since Asahi Shimbun seems to have a very good financial standing, they said, yeah, they're to the financial support. And they started to talk to the Science Council of Japan. And the chair of the Science Council of Japan, Mr. Kaya Seiji, said, wow, that's great. I thought, and I wouldn't be able to do that, but and I really love to challenge this. And now one of the researchers in the Tokyo University also joined this project. And in July already, they decided that this is going to be a national project. And of course, they need financial support. And then we were asked, and Asahi Shimbun was asked to support financially. And in October already, the Antarctic Expedition Operation Office was set up in Asahi Shimbun. Well, at that time, we didn't call that a research expedition. We just called it an expedition. And that was a starting point. And Asahi Shimbun supported the aircraft, a helicopter, or some vessels to look into the Antarctica beforehand. And all of these were supported, lent out by Asahi Shimbun. And in Brussels conference, we were admitted to join the Antarctic project. And Asahi Shimbun wrote that in the first page of Asahi Shimbun. And then Asahi Shimbun declared that they are going to support this. And 100 million yen was donated for this project, and then also Asahi Shimbun called out for the donation from the public, and 40 million yen was collected from the public. So there was a lot of the enthusiasm going on among the public. We also did that training because nobody has been to the Antarctic, and we have to be able to cope with the cold and the situation, the environment. So they went to the Hokkaido, Tofutsu Lake, and then they built up their hut and then brought in a lot of the equipment. And for the 3 weeks, they did the training to go to Antarctic. So with all of this, since the plan had started, within just 1 year, 1956 in October, the first expedition team started its journey on Soya. Soya is the name of the vessel. And as you can see, so many people were here to send it off. Thousands of people were on the pier. So there was a real enthusiasm of the Japanese public. So Asahi Shimbun, since it was providing the support, and this is just some of the picture that we supported, and the helicopter, and also the airplane Sachikaze. They said they need some journalists and some technicians. So Asahi Shimbun sent 10 staffs. And this is the first wintering team. Out of 10, two of them became the first two members to winter, Fuji Tsuneo. He used to be covering, and Sakuma-san, who was in charge of the telecommunication. And here, Nozomi Murakoshi. This is the father of the Dr. Murakoshi. You just heard the presentation. And the second and the third expedition, we also, there are some of the journalists accompanied. This is Mr. Yamamoto. This is a big news. I think all the Japanese people know about this. When the second expedition gave up their wintering, they left 15 dogs on Antarctic. However, when they came back to the Antarctic, two of them were alive, Taro and Jiro. That was a really an impressive moment. So this is how Asahi Shimbun have covered this. However, if one company is doing this covering, that is not a good way. So, and some are the Kyodo Tsushin and a journalist and joined to us. And we decided that we are going to do the pooling manuscript system so that those who did not participate in an expedition can gain some articles from here. And this is all continuing right now, up until now. So I think Asahi Shimbun sent our members to the expeditions, you know, for some time. But that wasn't up to the 20th expedition. And then after for a long time absence, and myself and one cameraman who is called Takeda-san, started to join again, starting from 2003 up to 2005 as the accompanying personnel or accompanying the journalist. So this was the job that we did on Antarctica. We set up the internet network using Intelsat. Intelsat antenna was being built. In 2004, in February, for the first time, Showa Station was able to have the constant internet network. That was a really revolutionary for us, because, you know, we can send our articles right away, not only the text, but, you know, we can send the pictures and even videos. And we can do that, you know, very fast. And since then, we were able to have this kind of the technology, in 2004, we started Antarctic Classroom. Using this satellite network, we connected ourselves to the classrooms in the school. And this was called Antarctic Classroom. And we have done this classroom 16 times in 2004. And this has been a regular program right now. And every year, and we repeat this classroom. And in 2009, and teachers were dispatched to the Antarctica as well. And this was under a new scheme. Two teachers joined the expedition team every year. And Ikuta sensei, that Ms. Ikuta is going to talk about. Since we were able to send the text, the photos, and the videos, and then I wanted to do more. In my first expedition, I went to the Dome Station, which is about 1,000 kilometers away from the Showa Station. And I lived there for about 1 month, and it took me 4 months to come back to Showa Station. But even under such circumstances, I always wrote the, I always sent the blog or journals every day. And on the 15th expedition, I lived on the ice on Selondane Mountain. And even at that time, I brought my portable satellite, and then I transmitted the blog and the journals. And then the last one, 61 expedition, and I used the Twitters every day. So faster and more beautiful and more interesting media. That is being required to do as a journalist, because we always want the public to look at this. And for this year, I first used the drones on Antarctica. It's like if you look around, and all and everywhere is all white. And this is one of the drone videos. Now, I have experienced three times in expeditions, and then once we go there, and I want to do something more next time. So more surprising features and pictures, and we want to talk about more about the observation and the research. But not only the Antarctic expedition of researches, discovery cannot be made every day. And also these days, we have so much information everywhere, and anybody can access to the information anywhere. In such an experience, what is the significance of myself being there? Then we should report something nobody else can talk about, something that would be compelling to the public. So, because the communication method was got easier, we thought that we need to more focus on the contents, and it is getting difficult. in the beginning of the Antarctica expedition, everybody was so interested, and no matter what we did, they just wanted to know that. And however, since then, it has been a long time, and people started to lose interest in this. But if we look around the world, we have some climate changes and environmental issues. In order for us to understand more about the Earth, I think the Antarctic expedition would be useful. And this is what we can do. So from this perspective, I would like to bring out some strong message. I would like to question the people through my message. And then this is the journalist role, I believe. So we are going to collaborate with the research people so that we can pass our knowledge to the next generation, or maybe we can send a message to the next generation expedition teams. This is my first time to talk about this message, because I don't have much opportunity to talk about this, but I'm very glad that I was able to talk about it. Thank you very much for your kind understanding and the listening.
Thank you very much. Thank you for sharing this wonderful image. Now, we would like to welcome the third presenter. It's Ms. Yoriko Ikuta. Please prepare. Ms. Ikuta is the teacher at Nara Prefecture Seisho Junior and Senior High School, teaching math and science. But she joined the high school in 2009, and she has started the teaching the inquisitive science, which is set by the school, where the students will be engaged in the inquisitive activities by setting their own research study. And she has joined a JARE expedition program from 2016 and 2017, and we are wearing the same jacket, so we are the colleague in the JARE. And in 2019, she won the Education Minister Award for Excellent Teachers in January 2019. Okay, Ms. Ikuta, please. Thank you for your kind introduction. And I would like to express my appreciation for this precious opportunity. Today, I would like to talk about the dispatch of the teacher and to the Antarctic, and also the inquisitive study. There is something that I'm quite convinced of. That is, using the Antarctic expedition, if the students can make the inquisitive study, I believe it would lead to their own growth, and they would recognize their own growth, and they would have be more motivated to study, and they can make their dream come true. So this is what I would like to talk about. But first of all, talking about myself, I am the teacher teaching science in the Nara Prefectural Seisho Junior and Senior High School. And I am also teaching the biology and inquisitive science. And I joined the 58th JARE, and for the reason that they thought that my activity was good, I was able to win the Education Minister's Award for Excellent Teachers. Talking about my own high school, it started out as the first public science math oriented high school in 2004, and our high school was designated as a super high school in 2011. And we also have become the senior integrated junior and senior high school. And the purpose of JARE is, at the beginning, was to publicize this JARE activity and also improve the quality of the teachers. So up until that time, the teacher was conveying the precious opportunities and the environment in the Antarctic. However, in Japan, the focus of the education is more shifted to the learning process of the students. So that is why from now on, this teachers at dispatch program is meant for giving opportunity for teachers to have inquisitive study, and the teachers are supposed to be acting as a facilitator. And in my class, talking about the inquiry science or the inquisitive science, it focuses on the experiment and observation, and the students are supposed to identify or the search for the challenge themselves, and they also need to explore the challenge and find solution. And through the repetitive cycle of inquiry, we will have the we will be going up the spiral of PDCA cycle. In other words, this would foster the students' ability to explore by themselves and communicate about their activities. And of this, we have a class for this inquisitive science. So the seventh grade up until 12th grade, all the students in the junior and senior high school will take this class. And one group would consist of 3 to 4 students. And they would select theme by themselves and conduct experiments. And it is the theme is limited to science and math. The level of this study is quite high. And in the Nara screening, we have won the school awards for 8 consecutive years. And there is the thesis, this is the thesis constant for men for senior high school. And it is also become acting as the barometer for the level of education. And through this class of inquisitive science, they would come to know what they are interested in, and then it would help them seeking for their career path. And the Kyoto University scholars have also mentioned that this is a very precious example. And now let me talk about this the Antarctic class. This has been done over several years. So even other than the period where the teacher is dispatched, this is being conducted. And after returning from the Antarctic, I am still engaged in this class. There's almost no other school that conducts this kind of a multi-year initiative. And we have done the study to compare the power generation of the biology in the Showa station together with students. And the students came up with these ideas, and we have done the experiment in the Antarctic, and the students have done this experiment in Japan too. And we have put together the result of the survey. And NIPR mentioned that this quality of the presentation and the study was very good. However, at the beginning, we had difficulties, and many people recommended us to stop this because the students in the senior or junior high school to do the study and to make a presentation in the limited time, they said it was impossible. However, the students, after the students accomplished them, they were highly commended to say that the students in senior or junior high school can do this much. And this shows the scenery of the class. The themes are, as I told you, it was about the study about the power generation of the microorganism. And whether the volume of the microorganism or the is different depending on the location. There has been no prior study, and this, and we were through this initiative, we were able to demonstrate that the students can do the first in the world research. And this photo shows how I have done the experiment that was conceived by my students. And this photo shows the presentation made by the students. And these two photos underneath are the classes connecting a Showa station in the Antarctic and my school. And the result of the questionnaire of the study And so we asked students whether this study helped them to think about their own career path or their research study, and 80% of the students had the positive response. And the second question was whether this study has led them to increase the study or the interest in the natural science. And the 95% of the response was positive. And then, when it comes to the students who were engaged in the joint study, the 100% of them had the positive response. So I believe this demonstrates that it is highly effective to have this kind of joint study between the teacher and the students. And just the other students who are not engaged in the study, just by looking at this the study felt very much impressed. And in the in this science contest for junior and senior high school, so after returning from the Antarctic, every year several students have won awards. In this way, students usually think that the Antarctic is something that is far away from them. However, our students will know and see how their seniors are playing an active role, and they are getting advices from their seniors, and they are getting advice from the researchers in the Antarctic. And by doing so, they would take it personal, and they would feel that they themselves were engaged in solving the issue. So they are now starting to take the Antarctic study personal. And then they would proactively do the study. So this should, to take something personal would lead to make students think on their own and make their dreams come true. So if we choose an inquisitive study for the Antarctic, they would they would proactively study, and they would make their dreams come true. And I think this would lead to fostering the people majoring in science and engineering. So I would like to conclude my speech by wishing for the further development of this program. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Ms. Ikuta. So this is a hybrid conference. Therefore, then I have to start on time and I have to stop on time. And we only have a little bit less than 20 minutes. Now I would like to open the floor for Q&A. So those people who are already in the venue, if you have any questions, please go to the microphone. You can find a microphone on the both sides of the venue. And then if you approach to the microphone, I would understand that this is your intention to make a question.
For the participants online, I would like to ask you to raise hand using the Zoom function and wait the chair's assistant indication specifically for you to speak.
So while we are waiting enough for the question to come, so all of us are now wearing JARE jackets, and some of you, the one we are wearing a very old one. So based on your experience as a part of the JARE, and I would like to seek, and I would like to start that we have discussed about the what kind of the contribution that we can make for humanity, social science. But not only going to the Antarctic, but we would like to consider the significance to work as a part of the JARE. And what are the constraints? I would like to ask each member to talk about this point. And Dr. Murakoshi, and you are doing your research in or under JARE. So if you go out of the scope of the JARE, do you have any possibilities to do the research out of the scope of the JARE? And Mr. Ikuta, Ms. Ikuta, were you able to have a benefit of the added value by participating in JARE? And Ms. Nakayama, and we understand that the journalists and the newspaper companies have made a significant role in the last history of JARE. Now, for the future, the collaboration between journalists and the researchers, would that happen? What kind of the possibility do you foresee? And how and what can we do under JARE? And so I would like to start from this question. Dr. Murakoshi, would you like to start? Thank you very much. Well, I go to Antarctica, and then I want to do the risk cognition. And then when I talked about this to my senior researcher, they said, well, that's great. And of course, anxieties for the risk. Now, that is quite natural to happen in Antarctica. So from my point of view, how should we look at the risk? How can we avoid the risks? And this will be defined from the cultural perspective. I have never talked with other countries and members, but whenever I hear from the Japanese members, well, other countries has a different perception or cognition about the risks. Probably this is because of we have the different cultural background. So I think this is one possibility to do the research. And I think if we go through with the JARE, we can identify what is the specific risk cognition in Japanese. And Ms. Ikuta, what do you think?
I believe there are two reasons. One is from the Arctic researchers, students will have opportunities to learn directly from the researchers. And the objective of the JARE and the objective of our school were perfectly matching. That's why I believe it is sustainable. Regarding the first point, students, you see, the Antarctic is something far away from them. However, the people who are actually in the Arctic, will provide advice to the students, and by having suggestions and from the researchers, students would take it personal, and then they will feel more motivated to learn and study. And to go as an organization, if I go there as an individual, it can end up as being a precious occasion. However, being conscious of the objective of JARE and our school, I believe this program is becoming sustainable. I believe that people who went to South Pole have a lot of occasion to make lectures. However, how many schools are we having this kind of sustainable project? I believe that is because that we have our own objective as a school that is matching with JARE.
Nakayama-san, what do you think? Well, mass media is related with the news, and our role is to disseminate the news. So this accompanying journalist role is to disseminate an information as soon as possible, and that is a good point. But the other way to look at this, and once we disseminate information, that's it. Since I've been working with an Asahi Shimbun for a long time, and I can continue to do this project for a long time, but some companies have joined this expedition only once. But this Antarctic expedition continued, and we have a long history of each topic. It is not a fragmented one, but so if we join them all together, if we put them all together, maybe we can make a good story of that. And if we could have some chronological history, and if we could put them together with the researchers or other companies, I think that is going to be a good potential for their research. Well, along with the researchers, we do have the video as the record of the expedition, and maybe the researchers can use that, you know, when they make a presentation in the academic conference. So that is another way than for them to utilize us. Or maybe we can do, we can give some of the education materials, or maybe just for the enjoyment. And I think this kind of the project can be thought of.
Thank you very much, Professor Murakoshi and Ms. Ikuta. Do you have any question to other presenter or any additional comments? We have not received any question from the floor. What about the via online? Okay, looks like we still have some time, so please give us additional comment. Okay, I have a question to two ladies. As we can tell from today's presentation, I am engaged in a study in the humanities and social science. Well, listening to the presentation, I think it is not something that is that fabulous. Well, visually, it's not that we can see something that is extravagant or anything in the scenery, but as you can tell from my presentation, it has very unique, severe environment. And that is why I believe there's a room for the humanities study. So my question is, the first one is for Ms. Nakayama. So this kind of study achievement in the humanities, and how can we communicate about the charm of this kind of humanities studies? That is my question. How can we convey the charm or attractiveness of this study? And for Ms. Ikuta, my question is, natural science is something very easy to understand. It's very simple, and it is you would have experiment, and you can be proactively engaged in that. However, it's difficult to show such kind of thing when it comes to humanities studies. And this may not be your expertise, but how can we make your students be interested in the humanities studies? I would like to ask for such potential. So, Ms. Nakayama, please.
Thank you. Well, I never think that your research is low profile or not interesting, but whenever I go to the this kind of an environment, and I'm so interested, what are they eating and how do they live? Can they sleep? I'm always interested in this. Of course, the science is important, but we are there, human beings are alive in there. For example, if you go to the space, how do they live? I'm also interested in that. I'm interested in the human activities. So I think that other people are also interested in how they live in their severe condition. And I've already been there in two wintering teams, and I know that there is a big drama and under such severe conditions. And this kind of the experience is not being disclosed so much, but I think there is a possibility for us to talk about that. And we often say the Antarctic expedition, but the snow, the light, northern light, and the oceans, and everybody would think about that. But once we start talking about the science, and then we are going to see some new horizons. Now, when we talk about the science, now we don't have to think about the division between the humanity or science research. All we can look at is the challenges and what we can make. So we are going to be, I think the era is that this is a time that when we can move on to the frontier work.
Okay, how can we convey the charm to the students? Well, actually, I couldn't cover this today, but one of our objectives is the social contribution. That is one of the objectives of our school. So students, as a matter of fact, separate from the inquisitive science, there is the integrated science. And what we're doing is that how it's the something that where the students gather data to show how they can contribute to the society. And so I think once again, it's about how to make it take it personal. Not only Professor Murakoshi making lectures, but on the continued basis, you should be engaged. If you engage in a certain school and if you give advice to the students, I think the students will take it personal. In Japan, nowadays, students in classes, I believe they are more of the classes are shifting so that they would focus on the students and thinking about themselves. But just listening would wouldn't make them take it personal. So regardless of the field, I believe this is true. That is why I would like to ask Professor Murakoshi to act as facilitator be in front of students. And if you like, if you're okay, please visit our school. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your answers. Yes, and if I have opportunity, I would love to visit your school. And as I talked in my presentation, Antarctic, and it is not only the site and the field, you know, for the science, but you know, we human beings living there. So there's another opportunity for us to learn. So from that perspective, as I mentioned, well, JARE has the field and has the basic to accept the humanity social science study. Now, this is a time that when we start, we should start thinking about the contents, because each researchers have the different topics for their research. And we should look at all these type of the different researches. And as one of the researchers, I would like to be a facilitator for that. And this kind of the research and expedition have to organize to welcome and accept all the people. And now when we start to look at the humans, since we are all humans, and we are always have the issues between people psychologically. So this is something a bit different from the medical studies. So I think this is also going to be the another possibility for the research. Thank you.
We have received a question via online. First of all, we would like to take first question.
When you intervene, I will call your name, and please verbally identify yourself and also affiliation, and concisely, please have your comments or questions to the panelist. So I would like to call Adele Jackson from the online, and you can unmute yourself and video on if you like, and pose the question. Thank you, Adele.
So dispatching artists to the Antarctic, I think it's ongoing, and a lot of countries are considering this and looking at Antarctica as a field for the artists or art. Do you think, Nakayama-san, do you have any possibilities to cover this as a journalist? Yes, I have heard about that from the very other countries. And a calligrapher went to the overseas non-Japanese station. That's what I heard. And JARE also considered this. And then one of the artists tried to join the expedition, but because of the health issues, and then this person was not able to join. And on the 50th anniversary, and one of the artists went to the Antarctic, and a writer went to the Antarctic and wrote a novel there. That's what I heard. But this is one of the examples in how an artist can join this kind of expedition. Thank you.
So I think we can take another one from the online. So can I ask Spirita Suman? And so could you identify yourself, affiliation, and pose the question precisely? Thank you. Thank you, Spirita. So,
okay, let me explain my interpretation, including North Pole. In order to increase the interest in, from the general public, you know, how, what we can do to increase the interest in the Arctic or the Antarctic. I believe the approach from the media and the media from researcher can be different. And as the high school students, what can you do in order to raise an interest to the Arctic or Antarctic? So we don't have so much time, so could you please give us a few words how to increase the public interest? Dr. Murakoshi, well, in my case, you know, I'm specializing in risk, and this is not only about the Antarctic or Arctic, but I believe this is also linked with the ordinary society. So I think we should talk about the link or the connection between the two, and what the significance of this study. And I believe the interpreting that is the role of the researcher.
This is what you're always doing. And then if you focus on the polls, what do you think about this? How would you answer? Well, I often joined in, I often speak at the lecture meeting all over Japan. And then if I, once I start talking, and even though the public were not so interested, they started to show interest. Or if they hear that there is a lecture on this, some children really work hard in advance to get some knowledge before they hear my lecture. So what we need is a little trigger. So mass media, I think we should disseminate this kind of information at any chance, at any opportunities. And at JARE, the researcher who does not have the station in Antarctic, and JARE is considering to invite some researchers from those countries. Yes, there was. And at that time, the Thai researcher came with the Japanese expedition, and the Thai journalist came with us. And Ikuta-san, what do you think?
I believe it will be good to show the students a presentation. For example, if it is among high school students, when they gather, they have a very interesting discussion. And then the other school also held a workshop reading books about the Antarctic. And the parents, and by looking at the presentation of their own children and looking at the students' presentation, they might not have any interest, but they would realize that, I think it will be very worthy if they could realize the value of this Antarctic education. Thank you very much.
Now it's time to close. Well, for the first time in Asia, we were able to hold this call chance. And with all the Japanese stakeholders, we were able to discuss about the Japanese researches. And I hope this is not going to be the end, but this should be the start point for this study, including young generation. We would like more people to choose this pose as a topic from the various fields of the research, including psychology or legals and whatever. And I hope this is going to be a great trigger to start a new research. So now I would like to conclude this session, Japan session. We are going to take about 5 minutes break. And as Nakayama-san mentioned, 1958-1959, there was the third expedition of Japan, and how they did that, and Taro Jiro, the dogs, two dogs, how and the survived dog, and now Asahi Shimbun contributed that in the video during the break time. And this is going to take about 25 minutes, and please enjoy that video. So I would like to conclude the Japan session here. Thank you very much for all the panelists.